Hello, this is Michael Sulak, and in this video we're going to be conducting a hypothesis test for the mean of a population. We will be using the p-value method, and the specific test that we are going to do in this video happens to be two-sided. Let's go ahead and look at the problem we'll be working on. Let's start out by reading it. For healthy adults, the mean pH of arterial plasma, which is the acidity of oxygenated blood, is 7.4. A new drug for arthritis has been developed. However, it is thought that this drug may change blood pH. A random sample of 38 patients with arthritis took this new drug for 3 months. Subsequent blood tests showed that the average pH of arterial plasma in these patients was 8.1 with a standard deviation of 1.9. Use a 5% level of significance to determine if there is evidence that the mean pH of arterial plasma in patients who are given this new drug is different from that of healthy adults. So that's a lot to take in at one time. Let's go through and point out some things that are important. First of all, in the first sentence, we're given the variable that we're working with. It's the pH of arterial plasma. And we're told that for healthy adults, the average is 7.4. Then we're told that we have a drug that has been developed, and they give this drug to a sample of 38 patients. So that 38 is the size of our sample. We use an N to talk about the sample size. And then this sample had blood tests that showed that their average pH was 8.1. That is the average of a sample, which we tend to write as an X with a bar over it. And the standard deviation of this sample was 1.9, which we write the standard deviation of a sample as a lowercase s. So then it says use a 5% level of significance. That's our alpha level, which we can write as the Greek letter alpha, so that's 5%. And we wanted to determine if the mean pH of arterial plasma in patients who are given this new drug is different from that of healthy adults. So this different is really important because you can be different by being more than something or different by being less than something. And that goes in two directions, which is why this is indicating that the test that we're going to be doing for this situation is going to be what we call two-sided. So we'll start out by stating the formal hypotheses, the null hypothesis and the alternative hypothesis. I tend to use an H with a zero for null, and I like using an A for alternative. And so these are both statements about a parameter, and the parameter that we're working with is a mean. It's the mean pH level of patients who are given this new drug. That's the mean of a large group of people, and that's describing a parameter. And when we talk about the mean of a population, we use this symbol mu. And the null and alternative always describe the same parameter. And the null hypothesis always has an equal sign. And because we want to know if this mean is different from that of healthy adults, we are going to use a not equal to sign in our alternative. And so different from what? From that of healthy adults. What was that? Well, that was this value given to us up here, this 7.4. The claim that you're investigating is always in the alternative hypothesis. And the null hypothesis is always a statement that I kind of like to think about it as a statement that nothing's going on. Null is like nothing. So the null would be saying that patients who took this drug have healthy pH levels, and the alternative would be saying that patients who took this drug had pH levels that were different from healthy. So those are the formal hypotheses. The next step that I always do is to calculate the test statistic. And as a little bit of theory right now, what we're doing is assuming that the null hypothesis is true and seeing how far our results were, these results being these statistics up here, and specifically this mean, how far this mean was from what we would expect if the null was true. And because we're working with a quantitative variable and sample size is relatively large here, our test statistic ends up being from a t distribution, and the formula for it looks like, and to make the calculations go a little bit more smoothly, I like to sometimes put parentheses around the top and bottom. Generally a good idea if you have a semi-complicated looking fraction. So we know what this value of x bar is. That was the mean of our sample. We know what this value of s is. That's the standard deviation of our sample. We know what this value of n is. That's the size of our sample. And the one thing that might not be super clear is, what is this mu naught? This mu naught is sometimes called the hypothesized value. It's just the number that appears in your hypotheses. We're comparing this to 7.4. 7.4 is our value of mu naught. So I'm going to go ahead and place the symbols in this formula with their numeric values. And it's definitely important to realize that this subtraction in the top needs to happen before you divide anything. You're going to get 0.7 in your numerator. And you generally want to be a little bit careful with values like the square root of 38, because when you find that, you're going to have a lot of decimals in your answer. And if you round some of those decimals, this will change the value of the square root of 38 just a little bit when you round, which will affect this calculation, which will affect your entire test statistic. So it's generally better to be more precise rather than less precise. I like to maybe go ahead and do the bottom calculation all at once. And if I use 5 significant digits, which is definitely plenty, and then if I go ahead and finalize this calculation, and maybe I'll just round that to 2.271. So that is the value of our test statistic for this problem. So once we have our test statistic, we can go ahead and do what's called finding the p-value. We are using the p-value approach in this problem. For me, it's the most straightforward approach. The p-value is a probability that comes from the distribution of our test statistic. Our test statistic in this situation is a t-statistic, and that means the p-value is going to come from a t-distribution. And t-distributions are described by a number, a single number called their degrees of freedom. The degrees of freedom is the sample size minus 1. And so since our sample size is 38, the degrees of freedom that we're going to be using in this problem is 37. And t-distributions look like normal distributions. They're bell-shaped, they're symmetrical. So I've done my best to draw a t-distribution with 37 degrees of freedom. Our test statistic is 2.271, which is a value on the horizontal axis here. And because this is a central t-distribution, the number in the middle is 0. I'm going to say 2.271 is, we'll say it's right about here. I mentioned that the p-value is an area under this distribution. And what area is it? It's the area that corresponds to our alternative hypothesis. We have this two-sided test where we want to know what's the evidence that mu is different from 7.4. So different from 7.4 could mean more than 7.4. which means that our p-value is going to include the area above our test statistic, but different from 7.4 could also mean less than. So with a two-sided test, we're going to be taking the area that's less than the negative value of our test statistic, the area that's less than negative 2.271 as well. So what that is all the area that is at least this distance away from zero. So this two-sided test, the p-value always has these two areas in them. But what's nice about finding the p-value is that these areas are the same. This distribution is completely symmetrical. And since we're the same distance away from zero, what we can do is just find one of these areas and double it. And whichever one you want to find, it doesn't matter. It's your choice. You have some creative license here. We're going to go ahead and find the area above 2.271 in a t-distribution with 37 degrees of freedom. There's lots of ways to do that. There are applets on the internet that will do it for you. There are computer programs such as R or Microsoft Excel or TI-83 or TI-84 calculators can find these areas for you. However you want to find it, it turns out that this upper area is 0.0145, which makes this lower area that same value. So the p-value is just the sum of these two numbers. It's this number plus this number, which ends up being 0.029. So now that we have our p-value, we're ready to make our decision. And the decision is always either reject the null hypothesis or don't reject the null hypothesis, which sometimes books like to write as fail to reject, just to be clever. And you make the decision by looking at your p-value and looking at your alpha level, which is 5%, but as a decimal, I could write that as 0.05, and seeing if the p-value is less than the alpha level, which in our case, it is. And whenever the p-value is less than the alpha level, you reject the null hypothesis. Our decision is reject the null hypothesis. You fail to reject if your p-value is greater than your alpha level. And again, to describe a little bit of the theory, why you end up rejecting the null if your p-value is small. Both the test statistic and the p-value are calculations made assuming that the null is true. And the p-value is essentially the probability of seeing the result that we did, which was our sample mean of 8.1, if the null is true. That probability is fairly low. And so one of two things had to happen. Either the null was true and we just happened to observe something that was unlikely. That's always a possibility. Or the other possible scenario is that the null is actually not true. And so when you get a small p-value, you're getting results that are quite unlikely if the null was true. So what you think is probably actually the case is that the null is not true, which is why you reject the null when the p-value is low. How low? Lower than the alpha level. So we've made our decision. We are going to reject the null hypothesis. Sorry. So at the end of the day, all this fancy science doesn't mean a whole lot unless we can explain what just happened. And we are going to do that in what I call the conclusion. So we're going to summarize what happened with our data and what it told us about the research question that we wanted to know, which is, do we have evidence that the average pH of people who are taking this drug is different from healthy adults? And since we rejected the null and we rejected it in favor of the alternative, we are going to say that we have evidence that the alternative hypothesis is true. And I always start out by talking about our data, because if we had a different sample with different sample values, we might have gotten a different result. But our data provides evidence that mu is not equal to 7.4. What is mu? Mu is the mean pH of arterial plasma in patients who are given this new drug. So I'm going to write all that out. It's going to be a lot of words. We have evidence that this mean pH is different. And numerically, we found that we had evidence that it was different from 7.4, which was the healthy adult level. So I'm just going to be comprehensive and talk about both of those ideas. And then that we have evidence that it's different from the healthy adult level of 7.4. So that's the conclusion. And notice that the words in the conclusion aren't overly technical. We're not using the phrase hypothesis or reject or null. We're just trying to state this in everyday language so that if we were presenting this to a group of people that maybe weren't taking statistics, that they would understand what we're saying. We're trying to explain all this technical math using more or less plain English. So that is a two-sided hypothesis test using the p-value method. The first step was to talk about our parameter in the null and alternative hypotheses. The second step was to calculate the test statistic. The third step was to use the test statistic to calculate the p-value. And because we had a two-sided test with a not equal to in our alternative hypothesis, the p-value comes from the two outside areas, in specifically a t-distribution with 37 degrees of freedom. And then we used this p-value, we compared it to our alpha level, and we made our decision, which was to reject the null. And then we stated our conclusion, going back to what we were trying to determine in the first place, making a statement about what our data says regarding our research question here. I highly recommend doing these five steps whenever you're working out a hypothesis test using the p-value method. Although this can seem like a lot, the more you practice, just like anything else, the better you'll get. My name is Michael Sulak, and I will see you next time.